I'll just revise this and then continue. Now, a product hierarchy is a method of classifying company's product or services into a logical structure. Now, if you see the product need, basically it symbolizes the reason for which the product exists, why the product is into the market. It gives the answer for that, the basic need or the core need. Maybe if you consider this part, there would be like a healthcare, the security, rest, and all come into this category. Product family is the point of view of business market and is company specific. It refers to the basic need that the company's product satisfied. So here, when we say it's a product family, it's from the point of view of the commercial angle, from the perspective of business market. Now, all the product classes that can satisfy core need with a reasonable effectiveness, they come into this category. That is, to satisfy the product need, something should be offered to the customers. That is the intention of this product family. If you say product need is security, then maybe product family comes as a insurance. Security is the motive here. In product class, the terms product class and product family, much of the time they both are closer. There is a very thin border in between these two terms, which can be used interchangeably also for many companies. It specifies product family having unique function, also called product subcategory. Now in insurance, we have different categories. So you can take into consideration the general insurance, medical insurance, other financial instruments in insurance terms. That is the product class. The product line, that is, it deals with various products that fall under the umbrella of that one product class, which are closely associated to each other. Now, maybe due to the same functions performed by them, they are marketed to the same channels, they are marketed through the same strategy, they are sold to the same customers many a times, or have similar price range. Now, product type, this level now describes the items which are present in a specific product that shares one specific function. It is restricted to only one function. The product unit, product item, or a variant, or it is also called as a storekeeping unit. Now, this category differentiates the product type with a specific price appearance, maybe a size, maybe a flavor. So the variants are described here in product unit. Now here the product hierarchy stretches from basic needs to the particular items that satisfy those needs. Now here, this is the broad structure. At the basic level is the core level, and at the other end is the product unit. Now marketers need to come up with the strategy, okay, to satisfy the need, which products they offer, into which class it is, then product line and product type, and then goes to the product unit. Now here, we can see a diversion of the products available. Maybe company can think of offering the product with the different packages, that is different sizes, maybe colors, variants, which serves the different purpose. And every now and then they are looking for the gaps in this. Wherever there is a gap, the competitor just tries to match the gap in the market. So that's why one should understand the product hierarchy. Specifically, when we are concerned with a particular strategic business unit, these terms are very much helpful to analyze where the product stands when the company takes into consideration the product portfolio, okay, or design the product portfolio. It becomes very easy for them to frame the strategies. Now, any doubts as far as this is considered? So this is a pyramid. There is another example of cooking. So here you can give number of examples with stress from the basic to the end unit. Now coming to the next factor, the customer value hierarchy. Now the previous one was from the perspective of the manufacturers or marketers point of view. Now this is concerned from the customer's perspective. From the customer's point of view, when the companies take into consideration, so this is the figure. Just have a glance at it, that how from the inner core benefit, the product get enlarged to the potential product. Now this is with respect to the offering. Now basic thing is that a product is anything that can be offered to a market to satisfy a need or a want. Now products that are marketed, they include physical goods, they include the services, the experience, the events, the persons, the places, properties, organizations, information, ideas, anything is marketed today with the help of different strategies. Now, in planning, it's market offering. The marketers, they need to think through 5 levels of the product. From the customer's perspective, the marketers needs to think. Each level adds something more to the customer value. And that's why it's a customer value hierarchy. The most fundamental level is the core benefit, which is inside the basic one. The fundamental service or the benefit that the customer is really buying. So when a customer is buying any product, he is not paying for the product, but he is paying for the thing which satisfies his need, the basic core. For example, when you visit a hotel, maybe you are hungry, you want to have your lunch or dinner or breakfast, and that's why you need to satisfy your hunger, that's why you are moving. So core benefit is hunger. If suppose you are entering into a hotel where you want to stay, so there you need rest and sleep. That it becomes the core need. We have today mobiles, handsets, electronic gadget. Okay, communication is the basic core. So here, this core benefit is step by step molded and packaged and then offered to the customers by moving ahead with these different levels. Now this marketer, it's a job of the marketer to turn the core benefit into generic product by giving them the offering in such a way that the core benefit need is satisfied. Like for communication, we need the mobile, we need to speak, we need to communicate with the other, we need that. You want rest. Imagine a hotel room totally blank. Okay, not possible. Maybe you need a bed, you want to have a rest. You need the basic amenities. So that is the basic product. Expected product. The marketer prepares an expected product, that is a set of attributes and conditions buyers normally expect when they purchase the product. So here, whenever today the customers, they think of purchasing the product, there are certain expectations. Even when we buy certain product, we have certain expectations. That is a set of features or characteristics that buyers normally they expect and agree to when they purchase a product. Now here, the customers, they are trying to match, okay, what they are purchasing, what are their expectations from the product and what they are getting. So the cost and the benefit, okay, there is always a calculation going on, much or less, in the minds of the customer regarding the price attribute and the value attribute. So what are my expectations, whether they are fulfilled when I purchase a product, and how much is the amount which I am paying. So the evaluation is ongoing. Now the hotel guests expect maybe a clean bed, fresh towels, working lamps, a relative degree of quietness and calmness. Because most hotels can meet this minimum expectations. This might be the minimum expectations. A traveler normally will settle for whichever hotel is most convenient or least expensive. Today, maybe the expectation is that they should have a Wi-Fi connectivity in the expected product itself. Now, with the time, as the time goes on, progresses, the levels, they go on upgrading. Upgrading in the sense from customer's point of view. Now at the fourth level, it is an augmented product. The marketer prepares an augmented product that exceeds customer expectations. So whatever is beyond customer's expectations is considered as the augmentation in the product or augmented product. The inclusion of additional attributes, benefits, or product-related services that serve differentiation in the product from its competitors. Okay, so here, this is one of the platforms where the competitors always look to differentiate and offer to the customers. Today's competition essentially takes place at the product augmentation level. Product augmentation leads the marketer to look at the user's total consumption system. The new competition is now here, it's not between the companies to produce in their factories, but between what they can add at this factory level output, maybe in the form of increasing the aesthetic value like packaging, services, advertising, financing, delivery arrangements, warehousing, and other things the people value for. Many a times, this part is thought of as an augmentation strategy, product augmentation strategy. Each augmentation which adds to cost, because when you increase the value, it will add to some cost of the basic product. Now here, the marketer has to think about this cost aspect, whether the customer is going to pay at extra cost, whatever is the value offered by the manufacturer or the marketer. Next thing, this augmented benefits, whatever is additional feature will be converted into expected product, that is into expectations. Maybe suppose this Wi-Fi and all were once upon a time augmented product, but today it has taken the place of this expected product. Today it is a bare minimum expectation of the customers. Now, this means that every now and then the companies will have to search for new benefits and come up with the new products which are going to add much more value. As companies raise the price of their augmented product, some competitors can offer a stripped down version at a much lower price. So other competitor may think of offering the same thing at a lower price also. Next step is the potential product. Now this includes all augmentation and changes, that is the transformation of a product which might undergo some changes in future. So here maybe delighting the customer, maybe the something which is more than expectation as well as augmentation. Potential product, we say, in future, which encompasses all the possible augmentations and transformation that might undergo in the future aspect. So future view is taken into consideration. Because of the digitization today, one can think of having more techno-savvy product values or service values included in the basic product. Successful companies add benefits to their offering that not only satisfy customers, but also surprise and delight them. So here, delighting is a matter of exceeding expectations. What is delight? When customer expectations, they exceed. Suppose if the company is able to give something more than the expected level, then we say it's a delight, customer delight. So the companies think every now and then of offering something new, adding value. Today we go to the banks, okay. Maybe tomorrow, or already it has been started. For some instances, it is the requirement of a bank that you need to visit. But today, because of digitization, there is less scope. Everything is possible with the gadgets itself. But maybe they can start advising or home services. Now here, even if you see the government sector, in case of government sectors also, the services have undertaken this aspect. Like the government employees visiting the residences for the sake of convenience of customers to save the time or just to make the services convenient for the customers. So this is with reference to the customer value hierarchy. Now the next part is the product mix. Now this product mix is also called as product assortment or product portfolio. A product mix is set of all products and items that a particular seller offers for sale. So here it includes all the products or items which the company thinks of offering to the customers. Now here if you see, I have given an example of product mix for Amul. And we will discuss the related terms here with reference to this. Now, before moving ahead, okay. Now just have a look at this. You might be aware of many of the products, you might have tried many of the products. This is just an example of one company, there are others also. Now here, basically, a company's product mix has certain width, length, depth, and consistency. These are the four components, okay? Width, length, depth, and consistency. These four frame the component of a product mix. Now the product width. The width of a product mix, it refers to how many different product lines the company carries. Okay. When we are discussing the width, that how many of the product lines does the company has. Here if you see for Amul, the first one is the milk. Second is the bread spreads. Third is the cheese. Then the beverage. Then the paneer, the dahi, ghee. So how much is the width? Now the length of the product mix. The length of a product mix refers to the total number of items in the mix. Now here if you see, when I say the product length, it is the total number. That is, if you see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 22, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33. So 33 will be the total length. This is total number of items which the company is offering. It is the length of the product mix. And when you think of the depth now, the depth of the product mix refers to how many variants are offered of each product line. So these are the variants. Variants in the sense, suppose if this is Amul Gold or Amul Taza, it comes with a different taglines or brand names, Amul Slim Line, Slim and Trim, Amul Tea Special, Amul Shakti, Amul Diamond. Okay, these becomes the depth. The next is the consistency. The consistency of product mix refers to how closely related the various product lines are in end use. Now here, if you see, basically Amul is well known as a for the milk and milk products. So if you just look at the heading in the product width, you will come to know that all these are associated with the milk. So there is some consistency in the range of products being offered by Amul. The production requirements, the distribution channels, or through some other one or the other way, how these products are linked. So it becomes much more easier to frame the strategies. Now here, since it is a milk and a milk product, company can think of having the same distribution channel for all of it. But suppose if it is varied, then the strategies are planned in a different way. These four product mix dimensions, they permit the company to expand its business in four ways. It can add new product lines, thus widening the product mix. It can lengthen each product line, looking at the gaps. It can add more product variants to each product and deepen its product mix. And a company can pursue more product line consistency. Now, similarly, if we take this as an example, okay, if you consider any company which is into the FMCG good, like fast moving consumer goods, there is a segment, maybe personal care is there, that becomes a different product line. That is the product line one, which caters to the personal care, product line two, which takes into consideration food and drinks, maybe product line three, which takes care of other aspects, other core need. And here, if you see into this, again, we have the product mix length in a single width. Suppose if it is a personal care, there also you will find numerous products included in it, like soap, shampoos, cream, toothpaste, detergents, okay, not detergents, sorry, but maybe into the soap category, again, you can take the liquid soaps, augmentation of the product. So here also you will see the product mix depth is there in the individual product line also, you can make these variations, the company can think of identifying the gap and offering the product here. Now, if you see the ITC mix, it is also varied. If you just see FMCG goods, you will find n number of items. Now, here also I have included a few, but one can think of stretching more for the ITC products. If you take hotels, it's a Welcome Group, Welcome Heritage, Fortune, Luxury Collection. All these are different brand names which specify or cater to different segments of customers in the market. Now here, this is with reference to Cadbury's. See the, just have a look at the variants, this chocolate, candy gum, biscuit, beverages, all is the, it signifies the width. Width of the product mix. If you see the product length, it's 15. The width is just 4, defined into different categories. If you see the depth, each individual product line will have its own products. Now, if you see here into the chocolates, you will find different variants of the product, the depth of the product. If you see candy gum, there are 3 products. Biscuits, 1 product. And beverages also you have. Like Tang, you have Bonvita, hot chocolate, cocoa powder. Tang is much more different as compared to the other 3. Other 3 go with the milk flavor, the other one with the water. So here there is a combination. So the company thinks of looking for a gap, or the customer is also having an analysis of the competitor's portfolio. So here, making such a representation or having an analysis of these gives the company a scope to think about the gaps. So maybe whenever the Cadbury's had come, it had previously thought of as a 5-star. 5-star was very famous once upon a time. And then the dairy milk. Then the next one, the celebrations was introduced. So whenever a company thinks of penetrating, okay, or challenging the traditions or shifting the customers, then it takes into consideration different products with a different brand. So if you consider an automobile company, if you consider any of the companies, you will find the company has its product mix varies. So initially when the company is new, it starts with a single product and slowly and steadily it adds to the product. Now here if you see, this is just the explanation of just what I had explained, what is the width, length, depth and consistency. Now here, if you see, everything includes chocolate somewhere, isn't it? So the consistency, if you see, it's very much closer. The products are very much close. The product lines are very close to each other. For ITC, it's not like that. If you have a look, everything is different. So we say it's a diversified or diverse product line it has. So whatever is applicable to one's product line length, the strategies, whatever are applicable to a single product line may not be applicable to the other. Since the product category is totally different, one needs to take into consideration different aspect. So the companies like this ITC or Reliance, they in case of such companies, each product line proves to be an individual strategic business unit, which is under the umbrella of a parent company. If you think of Reliance, it is into different product line lengths. So here, individually, each serves as a strategic business unit operating individually under the umbrella of the main parent company. No, any doubts here?
No, ma'am.
Now here, this product mix dimensions, it permits the company to expand its business in the following ways. Like it can add a new product lines, widening the product mix. So here, if we see, apart from these four, the company can think of introducing the fifth one. And below also, it can think of introducing new products. So this gives a new scope. If there is a just a brown chocolate, okay, now one can think of introducing the Cadbury's with the white chocolate. That is the total shift. That is the possibility here, which gives a scope for the company to come up with the variants. Instead of brown, they can come with the white flavors, with the mixed flavors. So here, it gives a platform for the companies to identify the gaps and position new products, offer new products which can satisfy the taste and preference of the consumers. Now, many a times, it may be a genuine product, okay, or it may be just enhanced by the company's ideas or the manufacturer's idea that this is the gap which is possible. It can lengthen each product line. So with the introduction of every new flavor, every new package, one can think of lengthening the product line, increasing the product line. It can add more product and deepen its product mix. One can think of adding to this product depth and go on increasing it. Now from consistency point of view, now it depends here upon the company. If we take this Amul, how much it can extend. Suppose if the company wants to restrict itself to the milk products, okay? So it can restrict just to the milk products here. But when we take ITC, okay? When we take off ITC or PNG or HLL, you will see that they are non-consistent. They are too much varied. So here, when the company is much more varied, the basic thing, it requires certain background. That is, the company should have a strong R&D. It should be financially strong, experienced to come up with the experimentations. It's not an easy task for the companies to enter into diversified business areas. Change the code. Now we move ahead with the product line decisions. Now this product mix consists of various product lines. Now why we were discussing this? Because we need to come up or frame with the strategies. Now usually company's objective is to influence the product line length. Companies which would look for higher market share and market growth will carry longer lines. So here they don't want any gaps. They want to reach to the end customer by offering all of the type and categories of the product. And that's why they think of carrying the longer lines. Companies that emphasize high profitability, those companies which just stress on high profitability, carry shorter lines consisting of carefully chosen items. So against this, okay, the first I discussed, there may be some other companies which may carry only a small, unique product lines and the motive is just higher profitability. But for this to happen, the competitor should be less. That is one thing. Second thing, the product should be much more unique. while offering the products. There should be something unique to offer to the customers. Then only there is possibility that customer would turn to their products and buy the products. Or we can say they have certain monopoly with reference to maybe technological aspect or aesthetic behavior or a brand value. So that should be made available to the customers. Product lines tend to lengthen over time. So slowly and steadily, if we see that with the increasing competition, companies think of coming up with new products every now and then. So they, over the time, the product line tends to increase. Excess manufacturing capacity puts pressure on the product line manager to develop new items. The sales force and distribution also pressures the product line manager to develop new items, new products. But as these products are added, several costs increase. When you think of increasing the product line, the cost is also increased. The designing cost, the engineering cost, the inventory carrying cost, manufacturing changeover cost, order processing, transportation, everything is going to get added, new promotional costs. So top management must think from all the aspects, specifically in terms of funds management. And that's why you need to have a portfolio management of these product lines. For the individual product line, there is a individual manager who takes care or who is responsible for that brand, for that product. Now, when the company takes into consideration the sales and profits of each item in their line, they come up with three strategies of building, of maintaining, of harvesting or divesting. Building, that is fighting with the competition and moving ahead, looking ahead. That is when we can say, if we consider with reference to PLC, product life cycle, the product is in the introduction stage and is building up, maybe through the aggressive promotional strategies like advertising, penetrating into the market, motivating the channel of distribution to penetrate into the market. Maintaining is when you are into the growth stage and you have more competitors. There are more competitors and the company needs to market, needs to manage the market share. It is struggling or fighting with the competitors and has to maintain and fight from all the aspects. Harvesting, that is, once when the company enters into the market, maintains, moves ahead, the profits start coming up. The profits start cropping up. That is, we can say it's a cash cow in a quadrant or in a matrix. It is a cash cow phase where you start getting more revenues. Or divesting. Divesting is when it enters into a decline stage, one thinks of just whether liquidation, whether just closing up and diversifying the companies. So basically, these product line decisions help in coming up with new strategies with reference to the basic product and the product decisions. Now here, as the same product cannot target the complete market, the product line is extended, which is also known as the product line length extension. So when you extend a product line, it is known as the product line length extension. You add extra products to satisfy the need of some specific or few customers which were left out in the initial stage. Now here, a company lengthens its product line in two ways. First is the line stretching and second is the line filling. So the options are to stretch your line or to fill the gaps. Now, every company's product lines covers a certain part of total possible range. For example, like if you consider a automobile, BMW automobiles are located in the upper price range of the automobiles market. If we take against this the Maruti company, okay, where it's catered or it introduced the product at the medium price range. So whenever the company comes up with the product, it initially defines what would be the segment it would be catering to with reference to its features and pricing aspect. Whether it would be very expensive, whether it would come into a special category or into a generic category, whether it wants to serve the basic purpose, core need, or whether it is into an augmentation. So based upon this, the product, it defines or gives an idea about the segment to which it wants to offer the product. Whether it's looking for the customers from the affordability point of view or luxurious products. Now here we have seen segmentation that it's based upon different criteria, segmentation. There are demographic factors, there are psychological factors, the geographical locations. In the previous semester, we have studied this. So on the basis of these criteria, on the basis of this segmentation, the products are formed or the ideas are transformed into the products which are offered to the end customers. Now, there are certain products where just you take the name of the brand and you will come to know about the segmentation or the price attribute, isn't it? Many a times we just come to know by having a look at the logo, by just coming across the brand name. We come to know about the details of the what might be the class to which this product is offered. Class in the sense segment I am speaking of. So let's have a look at this line stretching. Line stretching occurs when a company lengthens its product line beyond its current range. So when the company thinks of stretching, when it wants to increase product line beyond the current range of products it's offering, we say it's a line stretching. Just you want to stretch the product line. The company can stretch now with reference to the line, product line. Here we have the three strategies, that is the down market stretch, up market stretch, and both ways. The company can think of stretching both ways, up market stretch as well as down market stretch, or only up market stretch or only down market stretch. Now here, when the company thinks of expanding these strategies, it takes into consideration new product lines in the same product categories. We are not thinking of diversifying here from one core product line to the other. So here one thing specifically with respect to this STP approach, that is segmentation, low, medium, and premium products are offered here. Now let's look at the first one, that is the down market stretch. Now here many of the companies, after globalization and privatization, liberalization, the four-wheeler companies which entered into the market, they found that Maruti had a monopoly in India. So these companies initially, when they entered India, they came up with the higher segment products, the cars which entered in India were the premium cars, the luxurious cars. And they penetrated into the market, and after staying for a long time, they thought of stretching down to fight the competition with Maruti, that is offering the product into the lower category, lower price product. Now here, a company positioned in the middle market may want to introduce lower price line. Why does a company thinks of stretching down from the current upstretch market? So there are few reasons. Like, the company may notice strong growth opportunities in the down market. So here, when the company thinks that there is much more opportunity when you stretch down, if you see mass of the segment, suppose mass of the population is into this category, the lower price line category. So they see that there is a tremendous opportunity. I want to step down and offer the product which would be preferred by this category of customers. If the companies want to penetrate into the market, they need to aggressively market the customers, aggressively market to the customers by offering the product in this particular zone. The company may wish to tie up lower end competitors who might otherwise try to move up market. So instead of the competitors entering from lower segment to upper segment, the company thinks of stretching themselves down to beat this competition. If the competitors try to enter the upstretch market, the company would end up just defending themselves instead of the downstretch market. That is the threat from the low-end competitor. They may go for tie-ups with them, or they may have their independent strategy. Many a times we see that the market is middle market is stagnating or declining. In that case also, the companies can think of offering the products. Many times the companies feel that the market is more concentrated, or it reaches a critical point beyond which the company feels the sale will not increase as far as the premium products are considered, and that's why it thinks of coming down. Now here, there are certain examples like Surf, high price detergent market. It had a initially the competition from the brand Nirma. So it also came up with the low price detergent, a different segment with a lower price, and Wheel, it's still lower. Or if we consider the pens, the Parker, okay, just I have given different brand names and the prices. See the difference, 3,300 to 175. So it's a huge difference in between the pricing. So when you take into consideration this pricing, you will come to know the segment of masses or the strategy, segmentation strategy of the companies, and offering them the product. Basically, if you take into consideration the automobile industry, Tata Nano, here the company wanted to basically downstretch the market. At a very low price, they offered the product. But somehow it did not click that much at the expected level. Now, what is the reason for this? Any idea?
No, ma'am.
Yes. Why it did not penetrate as per the expectations of the company?
Due to price.
Due to price. Actually, they are offering the product at a lower price, much lower price. The customer should purchase, actually.
They went according to...
This is what is the downstretch strategy, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. According to
maybe
customer...
3 to 4 lakhs, which exists ma'am, in the market. Okay. And they found the gap and they introduced 1 lakh car. So, it's very low priced. So, still why the customers, they were not willing to purchase. And were pro to purchase the automobiles which range from 3 lakhs to 5 lakhs, mid-size segment I'm speaking of. Basically, you know, when we speak of car, it's a transportation mode, isn't it? Who will
yes,
have
ma'am.
A car? Who will be purchasing this car? Who are the customers which come into this category? Whether car
yes.
is a very basic need or it's a status symbol. Today,
yes.
it has become a need, but with the need, also it carries certain status symbol, no?
Yes, so, ma'am.
Here, what happened when this Tata Nano was introduced as a you know, low-priced car, that tagline, low-priced, okay, which actually the company thought as a tool to fight against the competitors, okay, that proved to be a boomerang for the company. So, many of the customers who were willing to purchase the car, they already had the budget much more. They had certain preconceived notions as far as the status, it was perceived as a status symbol. So purchasing Nano as a 1 lakh rupees car was perceived by the customer, was looked upon by the customer as very cheap or maybe for the poor class or mid segment. And that's why that was a problem. So this was a psychological barrier which the company could not improve. Though it had certain technical things to be taken care of, but the psychological segmentation was a basic problem as far as this product was considered. So one cannot think of just lowering the price and entering blindly. One cannot think of predicting the customer, what the customer will think. Now, just there are 2 minutes. So here, when the company is thinking of offering also, there should be certain differentiation, the perceived differentiation. Now, suppose here the Parker has offered the variants as far as the pens are considered. The pen of $899. The pen of 3,300. Okay, there should be some additional features or 1,900. So here, when the customer, okay, if the customer asks for just, he visits a retail outlet and asks for a pen, Parker pen, I want to gift it. Maybe the range is from 1,500 or 1,000 to 2,000, 3,000 in case. So here, the obvious question the customer might ask is, what is the difference, isn't it? Even we, when we go, we ask that this is the brand, okay, fine. Just tell me what is the difference in between the two. So here, the company should be able to justify why a particular pen is costing 1,900, while against this, the other is just 175, and the in between is 1,225. So this justification should be given to the customers. The features should be prominent. It should be able to reflect. Now, the substretch and all, we will have a look in the next session. Today I will not be able to finish. So in the next session, we'll have a look at this.
Okay, ma'am.
Any doubts as far as previous session was considered, product hierarchy, the levels?
No, ma'am.
We'll continue in the next session. Okay.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.